in the Sermon on the Mount. It has been such an encouragement to get to be with you. It has been an encouragement to make a lot of different connections and to enjoy an outstanding meal. I mentioned earlier our trips to the Wilson County Fair and stopping by the booth. And if I remember correctly, I think there's a cookbook that is available at that booth. And now I see why that's such a popular item, because this was just an outstanding lunch. And I understand that we have just eaten. And I understand that it's a Sunday afternoon. And I know what Sunday afternoons can do to you. The eyes get a little heavy. And I just want you to know that's okay. Someone told me years ago that if anyone ever fell asleep in a worship service, it just means that they really trust the preacher and what he's going to say. So I feel pretty good about that, so don't worry. But as I was eating lunch, I was reminded that this is not the first time that I have benefited from one of your special days and one of your lunches. When we were in college in 1999, we were part of the a cappella singers group. And I didn't recognize it till I went downstairs. We came here, we did a Saturday activity with the youth group, and then we were here for Sunday worship. If I remember correctly, Clarence DeLoach was preaching that day, and I could still remember his outline about the wise and foolish builders. And then we had a lunch outside, I believe, and we sang during lunch. And so we have already benefited from your hospitality, and it was neat to be reminded of that. And I know that we're one of many people over the years that have benefited from the hospitality of this church family. And so that's a very special thing that I'm thankful for. One of the neat things that happened during the break for lunch is also I ran into a few people who grew up or had lived in Michigan. I mentioned that's where my father grew up. It's where his family was, just south of Detroit in Flat Rock, Michigan. And, you know, sometimes there are family stories that become almost kind of like legends that are passed down and you enjoy telling the same stories. One of those was from the time when Dad played baseball. It was youth league baseball in Flat Rock. And they were playing on a team. His team wasn't very good, but he also knew that in the local Flat Rock newspaper, there'd be a writer out there who would give the box score and write a couple of sentences about what happened at each game. And so if you were playing Little League, you wanted to do well enough that you could get your name in that little article. And so one day they lost, but he had a really good game, and so he felt like this is going to be the day that I get my name in the paper. And so he got the paper that morning, he looked at it, it had a whole story of the game, they lost the game, a whole box score, and the last line was, Dave Phillips played well for the losers. And that's just sort of been over the years. You know, that's kind of a family joke. Dave Phillips played well for the losers. And I bring that up because when we begin reading about Jesus' passion for holy living, and especially when we begin reading in the Sermon on the Mount, he pronounces these blessings in the Beatitudes, the verses just before the ones that Kyle read for us. And you've got these Beatitudes that seem to detail the life of someone who's not a winner, the life of a loser. And I think that's important because all of us at some point have felt like losers. Maybe we feel a little bit like Charlie Brown, doing what Charlie Brown always does, and his friend Lucy is doing what she always does, which is moves the football at the last minute. Every time, maybe this time will be different. And we feel that way sometimes in life. You know, maybe, okay, I'm going to try it again. Maybe this will be different. And it doesn't work out that way. Or if you've ever watched the Harlem Globetrotters play basketball, at least when I was growing up, it may be different now. I can remember when they came to Memphis and we watched them play a team called the Washington Generals. If you've ever been to a Harlem Globetrotters game, it's a lot of fun, and I don't want to ruin the ending, but they're going to win. They win every game just about that they play, and they always played the Washington Generals. And I've wondered as I've gotten older since then, when you're a child watching that, you're just excited about the fancy shots and the dunks and the jokes that they play. I wonder what it would be like to be on the Washington Generals. And you just have to get up every day and get ready and play basketball, but you know that you're going to be on the losing team. And we know what we think of sometimes when we picture winners and we think of what we picture when we think of losers. And so sometimes that's associated with stuff that people have. Sometimes that's associated with the position that people have. And so when we get to the Sermon on the Mount and Jesus starts highlighting people that sound like they would be losers in life, and he's saying they're blessed, that gets our attention. In fact, if we're connecting it back to what happens in the Old Testament, there's a term in the Old Testament that we see for people who are often looked at as losers. The Hebrew term is anoim, and it often gets translated meek, humble, or afflicted. So in the Old Testament, they would be considered meek, humble, and afflicted. And yet, time and time again, we're reminded that those are the people that God takes pleasure in. So in Psalm 149 and verse 4, for instance, we read, The Lord takes pleasure in His people. He adorns the humble with salvation. Who receives salvation? The humble. Isaiah 49, the Lord has comforted His people and will have compassion on His afflicted, in verse 13. So these afflicted, humble people are the ones that God highlights in the Old Testament. It shouldn't surprise us that when we get to the New Testament, that's who Jesus is highlighting. He's looking at individuals that we might not think of as winners, but as we're reminded in this Sermon on the Mount, Jesus calls us to be different. So I'd just like to remind us of the Beatitudes here at the very beginning, starting in verse 3. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the gentle, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. Blessed are those who have been persecuted for the sake of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people insult you and persecute you and say all kinds of bad things about you for my name's, because of me. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward in heaven is great. Now let's just take our understanding of 21st century definitions of winners and losers. If we were to write the Beatitudes today, what would they sound like? What would the Beatitudes of what today's winners sound like? They might say, blessed are the rich, for they can purchase whatever they desire. Or blessed are the problem-free, for they won't have to deal with any difficulties. Blessed are those who are always ready for a fight, because they will get their way. Blessed are those who make their own rules, for they get to determine how they will live. Blessed are those without sympathy, for they will be able to do what is needed to look out for number one. Blessed are those who are not bound by morals, for they'll have more fun in life. Blessed are those who can pick fights with others and win, for they will be seen as powerful. Blessed are those who live a persecution-free life, for they won't have to experience pain or heartache. That's kind of what we hold up sometimes, isn't it? Maybe we don't even think about it, but those are the ideals that our society has as far as who will be a winner, but Jesus calls us to live differently. And so it shouldn't surprise us that when we get to this language about salt and light in Scripture, that He's calling us to a different kind of living. And I'd like for us to pay special attention to verse 20, where He says, I say to you that unless your righteousness surpasses that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will not enter the kingdom of heaven. I believe if we want to understand the Sermon on the Mount, it all starts with understanding verse 20 and just how revolutionary that would have seemed for Jesus to stand up and to say, unless your righteousness surpasses those of the scribes and the Pharisees. We tend to look at Scripture and we have hindsight. So we think about Pharisees and we think about them as the bad guys. And if they were in a Western, they'd be wearing the black hats. They'd be the ones who were on the attack. But if you lived in Jesus' day, and if you were a parent, it would be an honor for your child to grow up and be a Pharisee. They were the separated ones, separated out to study the law of God. And we see actually in the book of Acts that there are many of the group of Pharisees that become Christians. So we want to be careful not to paint with so broad a brush that every Pharisee we think of in Scripture is seen as a bad guy. And so for Jesus to stand up and say, your righteousness needs to be better than theirs, it would be almost like saying, your investment returns need to be better than Warren Buffett's, or your slam dunks need to exceed LeBron James. I mean, this would have seemed just outlandish that he would say, there's a righteousness I'm calling you to that's different than the scribes and the Pharisees. And then the rest of the Sermon on the Mount, he's filling in what that means. Because right after he talks about the scribes and the Pharisees, he launches into these contrasts where he says, you've heard it said, but I say to you. Here's the traditional understanding, but there's even more to it than that. And so he takes things that they had heard and they knew were right to live and they knew wrong things to do, and yet he says, there's even more to it. So murder is bad, but so is anger. And adultery is wrong, but so is lust. And he's pointing at these core issues for what it means to truly live a righteous life. He's called us to live differently. And so Jesus has a real passion in the scriptures for holy living. And it's a holy living that's not necessarily set up the way the Pharisees had, where they'd codified everything into the 613 commandments, depending on one estimate, 248 positive, 365 negative, and you've got to do all of this, and which ones are heavier and lighter? And Jesus is pointing at a transformation of the heart in this sermon. He's saying, if you transform the heart, then those commandments will follow. That holy living will follow. Now, when we read through the Beatitudes, as we just did, we might think, if I've got to have a righteousness that's better than the scribes and the Pharisees, and I've got to live according to the Beatitudes, I need to just keep myself removed from the world around me. I need to just sort of separate myself and kind of have a hermetically sealed compartment of a life that doesn't come into contact with all these things around me and all these people around me. But the beautiful thing about the Sermon on the Mount is it challenges us to righteous living and also reminds us that that righteous living takes place right where we are, right in the middle of the world where we live. And so he uses these examples of salt and light. An ancient writer, Pliny, would describe salt and sunshine this way: nothing is more useful than salt or sunshine. As Jesus often does, he's picking up images that would have been easily recognized and understood. We think about the way salt is used today. In a land before electricity and refrigeration, salt was used in different ways. In fact, if you read through Leviticus, Leviticus 2 tells us that there were some sacrifices that used salt. It was used as a preservative. Fishermen would use it to pack fish, and it was also used for payment in some cases because it was a valuable commodity. And so we think about the phrase, someone being worth his salt. Even some Romans would have salt as part of their salarium, or their payment, where we get the word salary. So there's a lot that's kind of connected to this idea of the importance of salt and light. Have you ever had one of those moments where after the electricity goes out, you realize how dependent we've become on electricity? You ever had that? And you think, well, the lights are out. That's no problem. I've got my cell phone. Until you watch that battery go down, you know, till it's 10% and 5%. We're more dependent on electricity than we might think. And so in a world without electricity, can you imagine the importance of light? Can you imagine how badly that's needed? And so when he's picking up on these elements, he's illustrating things that would have been vital needs for life. And even the phrasing of the city on a hill is something that would have been so familiar. Cities were set on a hill for a reason. You had farmland outside the city, but typically, if you had good, wide-open farmland, you didn't want to waste that on building a dwelling. You wanted to farm that. If you're up on a hill and there are walls around a city, you can see attackers coming. You can defend that city well. The imagery there would have been very familiar. Or even as we sing sometimes with the children about hide it under a bushel. No, I'm going to let it shine. Those bushels were important. You couldn't leave an unattended flame in your home if you're leaving. And so it might allow it to burn without starting a fire. But if you put a lamp under a bushel completely, it wouldn't just cover the light. It would extinguish the oxygen. And then now you don't have any fuel for that light. And so these images are so vital. Here are a couple of questions I'd like for us to ask as we think about this sermon. We could go a lot of different directions, but these two I think are important when it comes to holy living. The first is the question, is the world in us. Because salt and light are only really helpful if they're really different. For example, you didn't go in Galilee and find salt in its purest form. You couldn't pick it up at the store. You'd usually find it mixed with dirt and other substances. And so this idea of salt losing its saltiness happens when the impurities are out of proportion with the salt that's there. Salt is only really helpful if it's different than all of the stuff around it. And so if I'm going to be salt and light, I'm going to need to be different. Light exists in contrast to darkness. If there's a light that is so dim, it's not that much brighter than the darkness around it. It's not going to be very helpful. And there are several times in Scripture we're reminded of this over and over again. Here are just a few. When Paul writes to the church at Rome in Romans 12 and verse 2, and he says, "Do not be conformed any longer to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind," there's a difference there. Don't let the world squeeze you into its mold. You live differently. Or what about James 4 and verse 4 when he talks about friendship with the world? And he says, "Don't you know that that is enmity with God?" Or 1 John 2 and verse 15, "Do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him." There's this old statement that's often attributed to William James that goes, "A difference which makes no difference is no difference at all." Now, that's more than just clever wordplay. It's a reminder that if I'm going to say, "Boy, this is a difference, but it doesn't really make that much of a difference," well, then can I really say that's different? If I'm going to claim to live a Christian life and I'm not going to be any different than anyone else around me, am I really living that life? That's so important today because in kind of a postmodern world that we live in, people might not be excited about what Scripture teaches. They might not be excited about identifying as a Christian. Some might even be reluctant to do that. But everyone still has a sense that people who claim to serve Christ should be different than those around them. Have you ever thought about that? Even those who don't want anything to do with church will still be quick to point out hypocrisy when they see it in the church. And we understand that's natural. They should probably do that. But isn't that interesting that we still have this understanding there's got to be a difference? If someone claims to be a Christian, he or she has to be different. And so the question we ask is, the world in us is important. In fact, that phrase about salt becoming tasteless shows up four different times in the New Testament. Twice it refers to salt, about the salt losing its taste, becoming tasteless. But two other times it has a more common meaning of making one foolish. I think that's kind of an interesting connection. It could be salt becoming tasteless or making one foolish. And so we could probably think of examples in our own lives where we've got to make the choice, am I going to be different or am I just going to sort of go with a difference that doesn't make a difference? And I think of that because there are people and places that are different than where we live that have to make some pretty major decisions. I mentioned our trip to Thailand in class this morning, and there were two or three major things that happened in that trip that have really changed my perspective on life. But one is a conversation that we had with a young man who was in college at the time. We were all gathered there Monday morning. A lot of times we would talk with the students and we would kind of catch up on what they did over the weekend. And when we sat down with this one student named Yai, who was spending a lot of time with Christians, we found out that over the weekend he had traveled home, told his family that he was going to become a Christian. They in turn said, "That's fine, you'll no longer inherit our business. You are now cut out of the family will, and you won't have anything to do with us if that's your decision." He said, okay, traveled back to the Christians there where he was going to school, and started living the Christian life. And I can remember sitting there thinking, my entire life I've been around people who've encouraged me to become a Christian. What would it be like to say, I'm going to take a stand and be different than those around me? And what's even more encouraging is just a couple of months ago, I pulled up Facebook and saw him, his wife, and their children working with the church in that area. He started a Christian family of his own. It's incredibly encouraging, but it's a reminder that when it comes to serving God, we've got to be willing to take a step outside to be different. And so even in conversation, if someone sits down with me and they start in a joke, maybe a joke that they've heard, and I realize about halfway through that this joke is going to come at the expense of another group of people, that it's going to have some racist overtones that are going to treat another group as less than, how am I going to respond to that? What am I going to do? Am I going to be willing to be different enough to say, hey, I don't really think that's funny? Or am I just going to kind of let it slide so I don't really have to take a step out there? Or what about when there's a decision that comes up with what my child is going to be involved in? And maybe there are a lot of other families making decisions that I just don't think are right, and letting a child be involved in something, am I going to be willing to say, you know, we're not going to do that? Or is that pressure going to mount to the point where I just sort of give in and decide it's not that important to be different? I mentioned social media earlier. What if you post something on Facebook and someone makes a comment that's just inappropriate? Other people click on that, and you've got friends that click like and everything. And if you decide you're going to delete that, they're going to know that you've deleted something that you just don't think is appropriate. Are you willing to do that? These are simple examples, and we could probably sit here and come up with 20 other examples. Little choices every day that decide whether or not we're going to be different. But one thing that happens when we decide to give our life to God, our life to holy living, sometimes we're prepared to do the big things, or to make a big sacrifice. We might be prepared to give $100, but what if instead of giving $100, we pay that out day by day, one quarter at a time? It's kind of the way it is with faithfulness to God. Sometimes I'm not called to do the big things everyone's going to see, but it's those little decisions every day that add up to a holy life. It's those little choices that I make. And so it's a challenge for me to look at my life and to say, well, is the world in me? Can people see a difference? But on the other side of that coin, as much as I need to understand the difference there, I also need to ask the question, I can make a difference only if I'm different. But I also need to ask the question, am I going to be in the world? Here's some of the passages we mentioned earlier. So are we in the world? Because I also can't decide to live a Christian life in complete isolation from anyone else. It's not that living in the world is going to contaminate me to the point where I'm not going to be able to live the way God wants me to. That's one of the beautiful things about Jesus coming to earth and living, as Hebrews 4 would tell us, without sin, but he was in the middle of it. He was in the middle of his creation. He was associating with people from all kinds of backgrounds. So yeah, I need to look inside myself, but I also need to ask, where am I? This is a vitally important thing that we do every week. When we gather together to worship, I can't think of anything more encouraging, and it's incredibly important for us to worship God, to learn about His Word, to give to Him, to take the Lord's Supper together, to sing praise. And yet, also important is what's going to happen when we leave this building. Because our Christian life and our faith doesn't consist just of the time spent in rooms like this one. It consists of our entire lives. Am I in the world? You know, salt was often used as a preservative. And so I love that imagery of us as Christians being preservatives in the world. You know, why do we care about the way things get? Why should we not just look at the world and say, you know, things are so bad and so discouraging? And have you noticed how discouraging it can be to watch the news, to see what pops up on your computer, to see what the latest tragedy is? It's incredibly discouraging. Why not just say, that's not even worth it, I'm going to cut myself off? Because Jesus said we're salt. We're called to be preservatives in the world. In fact, we mentioned that rich young ruler earlier this morning. I love the phrase when we read about him in Mark's gospel, in Mark chapter 10, because Mark tells us Jesus looked at him and loved him. Here's a challenge. The next time you see something on the news that's happened that's discouraging, the challenge for us to follow Jesus would be to look at that situation, look at that person, and to love that person. Do you mind if I get a little more personal? What if, and we just came off an election and we hear about news all the time, what if you saw someone that had completely different views politically than you did, and we followed Jesus' example to look at that person and love them? I'm not saying you're not already doing that. I'm just saying it's a challenging thought, isn't it? Or if you look at someone who, even more important than any kind of viewpoint we might have about politics or the world where we live, what if someone that you know thinks Christianity is a joke? Isn't it challenging to look at that person and love them? That's how Jesus viewed the world. We're called to be in the world and to look at people and love them. It's going to be hard for us ever to evangelize or to share the gospel with anyone we fear or hate. I don't know if you've thought about that before. If I fear or hate someone or a group of people, I'm probably never going to share the gospel with them. And yet, if Jesus came to seek and save the lost, and he looked at people and loved him, then there's got to be a way that I can live righteously and holy, and I can be different from the world around me, but I can be right in the middle of people's lives, sharing God's word with them. It's an incredible balance that Jesus exemplifies. He doesn't just say, you are the salt of the church, or you're the light of the church. He says, you're the light of the world. The whole world needs to be impacted by you. What happens here is important. What happens outside these walls is important. I've thought about that in light of what we see in the Old Testament, where Abraham goes before God, and there's almost like this, it's really just almost a bargaining session back and forth, because God's going to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah. And finally, at the end of this bargaining, where he's almost saying, well, what about for the sake of this many people or this many people? He gets down to, for the sake of 10 righteous people, would you not destroy it? And God said, for the sake of 10, I will not destroy it. That's all it would have taken. I don't know if you've thought about that. Entire city. Lot's family was already there. Hopefully that would have been a start in the right direction. There's something about seeking to be a preservative in the world around us. And it's actually the mission that's modeled by Jesus. Because we can make a difference only if we engage in the world the way that he did. And so if you look at John 1, verses 4 and 5, in him was life, and the life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. What was it like when Jesus came to the earth? It was like he was shining in darkness. This is the true light, which gives light to everyone, was coming in the world. And notice in John 8, Jesus spoke of himself, saying, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, but have the light of life. Jesus says, I am the light of the world. In the Sermon on the Mount, he says, you are the light of the world. In other words, your job is to show me to the world, to do what I'm doing, to live the way that I'm living. And so just like we can never say, I just want to be like Jesus, it doesn't really matter how I live as long as I love people, Jesus doesn't give us that option. We live holy and righteously because that's what God tells us to do. That's what Jesus says in the Sermon on the Mount. But on the other extreme, I can't say, I'm going to separate myself from everyone so I can get this right. Jesus shows us we can live holy and righteous lives right in the middle of the world around us because we're seeking to share his message with them. I like the way Paul writes in Philippians 2 in verse 14 through 16, do all things without grumbling or disputing, that you may be blameless and innocent, the children of God without blemish in the midst of a crooked and twisted generation. By the way, one year at church camp, we started with verse 14, do all things without grumbling and disputing. That's a great theme for a church camp for a bunch of teenagers. Hey, without grumbling or disputing, let's see if we can do that. Pretty challenging, isn't it? So we started with that. But notice what we get to in the midst of this crooked and twisted generation, among whom you shine as lights in the world, holding fast to the word of life, so that in the day of Christ I may be proud that I did not run in vain or labor in vain. You're holding fast while you're shining a light. I love that contrast. We live holy. The world doesn't need to be in me. I need to be living differently. I need to hold fast to the word, but I need to be shining a light to the world. I love that balance. I love that picture there. And so when people see us, hopefully they don't look at us, but look at God. And so I appreciate so much when we read a passage like this that Jesus says, when you shine that way, in verse 16, they see your good works, but they glorify your Father who is in heaven. Who are we focused on? Thinking about our daily or weekly schedule, what are we doing that can point others to God? You know, sometimes people have associations about Christians that may or may not be accurate. Oliver Wendell Holmes once stated that he might have become a preacher, except he met so many that looked like undertakers. Now, that's no offense to anyone who might be an undertaker. It's just a little glimpse into what he thought about preachers. Robert Louis Stevenson once wrote in his journal that he went to church and didn't leave feeling depressed, as if that was a victory. You know, sometimes people look at us and they don't see the joy we have in living for God. They don't see the joy that comes in a Christian life. So what am I showing to others? What is the light that I'm shining? If I'm going to be seasoning, if I'm going to be sharing the light that God has given me and God has shown me with others, what am I transmitting? Is the world in me? Am I in the world? Am I salt and light? Now, just because I know what I know about this congregation, I know that you're finding active ways to be involved in the community. I joked earlier about the fair and the booth and everything, but there's no telling how many people you encounter through that ministry. There's no telling how many people have been blessed in this community by your work. And so as we reflect on this, let's let this be an encouragement to all of us to go out and to be salt, to be light, and to remember that Jesus doesn't have the same definition of winners and losers that we might have. Sometimes we might feel like losers. We might feel like we're the Washington Generals. But Jesus pronounced blessings on the people society often looked down on. He did that because when we live a kind of life where we're not building ourselves up, we're better able to focus on Him. If you need to start that life this afternoon, if you need to choose to humble yourself so that you can be glorified by God, if you need to decide to submit your will to His and to put Christ on in baptism, that can happen right now. There is no better way that we could end our time together than for someone to become a child of God. It may be that there's encouragement that you need, that you have a prayer request that you want to share with this congregation, this good group of Christians. I know they'll be happy to pray with you and to pray for you. If there's anything we can do to help you, please let us know as we stand and as we sing together.